the winner of 2 Golden Globe Awards, including Best Picture, and Best Supporting Actress Kate Hudson. The film on over 150 top 10 lists that Roger Ebert calls the most entertaining film of the year.
Ladies and gentlemen!
How old are you?
17.
Me too.
Actually, I'm 16.
Me too. Isn't it funny? The truth just sounds different.
I'm 15.
If you're going to be a true journalist, you cannot make friends with the rock stars. They're going to fly you places for free. You're going to meet girls. Oh, God, it's going to get ugly.
I am telling secrets to the one guy you don't tell secrets to.
I know what's going on.
I am a golden god!
I have to go home.
You are home.
Oh, man. You made friends with them.
Well, it was fun.
Because they make you feel cool. And hey, I met you. You are not cool.
Almost Famous, now on video and DVD.
Welcome to 90 Minutes on Film, the place where three distinct individuals give three distinct perspectives on movies that we love and sometimes, my favorite, we hate.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, man. Right here, man. What up? I am Wackoe, and we're right here, of course, with C.E. Garcia.
Yo, yo.
And the one and only Gabe, the Calilobo.
What's up, my man?
All right, guys. How you guys doing?
Good, good, brother.
All right. Well, for one, this is Gabe's favorite one.
Yeah.
Right? This is like...
What are my top movies?
Your top
right
ones.
Here.
Out of how many?
Probably. This is in the top 5 for sure.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So nice. This is a boner one for you.
Absolutely.
All right, good. So we know that. So that's Gabe's connection with this one. My connection...
Love that, Kate Hudson.
Yeah. My connection on this... Of being a music head and then just being in the industry and then just coming from like writing with magazines and stuff. So like, you know, that's my connection. But
not only that, I think your dad was a big classic rock.
Yes, he's head. A very big classic rock head, which is pretty interesting too. So he had like Humble Pie. He had all these different albums and stuff, you know, and that's where I got like, you know, my mom was all the oldies, disco and all that. And then my dad was the... same thing, but more classic rock.
Right.
You know, he was in Vietnam, so like
oh, yeah.
It was a big story. Like the music was the story of Nam, like just that music and what it was told. You know, so
yeah, I can't wait till we get into that music a little bit later.
Yeah. And then Chris,
yes,
and this is why I kind of getting this rolling here though. But Chris, you have a real big tie into this because you yourself is a musician.
Yes,
you know, you've written music and stuff. Yes. So, kind of elaborate more on that, man.
So I was in the music industry for about maybe 15, 16 years. That was my day-to-day job. I've worked with a lot of people over the years. And it's just interesting because this movie came around right before I started getting into the industry. And I can really say it had a huge influence on the way I approached the business.
Yeah.
And also the way I approached the people that I had dealings with.
Uh-huh. I see you in this too. There's each artist is like a piece of you. Like just me knowing you, like everybody from Jeff to Russell, like there's a piece of you and Jeff, like Russell all in there, like, you know, the characters and everything like that. But Lester, there's a lot of Lester in there.
It's funny that you say that because at the very end, you know, they're all pissed off at the kid for writing these stories about them. And, you know,
you're talking about Russell.
Yeah.
And Russell gets up and he says like, well, maybe we're not as cool as we think
exactly.
We are.
Exactly. Yep.
And that stuck with me my entire career in the music. It's like, remember, we're not as cool as we think we are.
Yeah.
And so I always approached doing music and being in the industry very humbly. And I think everybody that is listening to this that worked with me would agree. I always tried to stay very humble when it was, when I was doing what I was doing and when I was doing it. And it's just funny to watch this movie and how it influenced my attitude towards the business.
You still continue artists. To be that way though, Chris. You and I have talked about that offline multiple times. Mm-hmm. The artists you've worked with in the past and everything else, and just how you still remain very humble when you could really boast about the things that you've done through your music career.
Yeah, because I really pump you up a lot when I talk about the podcast and like who's involved.
I do the same.
So like, yeah, you know, but, you know, because we got to sell this shit.
Definitely. Come on, sponsors,
and that's,
if you're listening.
And that's the other part of this whole thing too. And that's the other part of this whole industry though, man. It's just the playing the role, playing the part, you know, and this, you know,
you got to have something that, that everybody
wants. And William learns that. And I think these characters through this journey, trying to get this story.
And I think the one, the gentleman that knows the most is Lester.
Yeah.
Cause he's like, he's seen it all.
Yes.
He knows what's bullshit and he knows the kind of trap that you're gonna step in if you step in that direction. He knows the you know, he knows the booby traps on what to avoid.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
And if the kid's only 15, which is
crazy,
is it, well, I mean, everyone tripped out and you know, as far as in the movie, they're just like, what the hell, you're just a kid. Like, you know, but you know, he proves him wrong. But
so what movie are we doing for the people that haven't seen it or watched any of our trailers online, our little teasers?
We are doing Almost Famous.
Yeah. Great movie.
Wow.
2000. Cameron Crowe.
Who, which is funny. I was at a Spinning Gold movie premiere. For those who don't know, that's a film that's coming out that talks about the story of the label, Casablanca, which brought out Donna Summers, Kiss.
Is that an Amazon movie?
No, that's out in the theaters.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't know that.
So, you know, it's the story behind all these different artists that were, like, you know, on that label. And basically, I saw Crowe there.
Oh, really? Yeah. You got that picture of him. You sent that text message to the
I sent it over, and I was like, yo. Like,
dude, it's, that was, like, serendipitous. Like, well, fuck, I guess we're doing Almost Famous for our next movie.
Right, because I think we were kind of like, I think we're going to do that one. And I think, after that, I was like, all right, fuck, I guess we're doing that
Might as well.
Right? Yeah. So it's kind of
And
fun.
Did he didn't say he wanted to come on the show this time?
Well, you know, we were chopping it up, and schedules just didn't match, and, you know, so.
Well, maybe we'll do Jerry Maguire next time. And
there we go.
You know, we'll give him a call and find out.
Or Tom Cruise, if he's listening.
Tom, man, yeah, Tom, you know, maybe we'll get Tom, you know, we'll see what happens with
if
that.
If we have time.
If we have time, though, but, you know.
Wacko, I got that same music background that you've got from your dad. I got it from my dad just after Vietnam and into that CCR.
Yeah.
And my mom into a little bit of that disco and everything else at that time. And so I get that same vibe from this. So that I think that's why it relates to me.
That's what I'm saying. Like with this film here, like everybody has some sort of like connection to it, and I think it's really cool. And one thing I wanted to tap into, like this coming from the media side. Like I started off actually getting into what now where I'm at, but the first thing I was doing, I was a writer for a magazine. You remember that?
Skinny
Magazine.
Skinny Magazine, yep.
Yeah, it was a distribution from just like California, Arizona, Vegas. But I started in that magazine. And one thing I did learn, and I want to kind of bring this out though, was I did a write-up with Busy Bone.
Mm.
And this is when he was separating with Bone Thugs and stuff, and he was going the solo route. And I think it was the album, like, you know, the Omega or something that he was trying to pitch out to or whatever. It was like the second solo. Anyways, I met up with Busy Bone over at this hotel, and we were just supposed to do an interview, talk about his new project, and then also get some photos in and stuff. So at this time, I was a writer, but I ended up later after this piece that we did, I ended up being the hip-hop editor because there was nobody that knew hip-hop. So point of the story is, met up with the guy, and he's supposed to sit with the label and stuff, so we only had like a certain time frame with him. We sat outside in the pool. This guy started telling us everything. Yeah, he was just like, you know, he goes, hey, you want a smoke? You know, because, you know, I was like, sure, whatever, man. So we're just like blazing on the side of this pool at fucking Hilton. Mm-hmm. And then he's like, oh yeah, man, I got kidnapped. My uncle kidnapped me. My dad kidnapped me. Told the whole story. I was on America's Most Wanted.
Like, what the fuck?
Yeah, and it's true. So he was sitting there. I was like, man, this is crazy. And it's crazy. That was just that. And then we had went into this whole backstory of him and then Bone. And he's like, oh, I remember the rhyme I spit. Then he spit the rhyme that he did when he went to Crazy Bone's house.
Uh-huh.
And he says, oh, I heard y'all trying to do a group. Let me show you something here. And he spit it and everything. I was just like, damn, I remember that shit. Damn. And
then that's how he got into the,
yeah,
the group.
Into the group. So he told this whole backstory on everything. I was like, wow, this is pretty dope. And then he's like, you want to go shopping? I was like, sure. Like,
he took you shopping?
Well, hold on. So okay. We were all like, I go, yeah. Like, we'll go to Universal. Walk. No. I want to go to Hollywood. I'm all like, fuck, you want to go over there? He's like, yeah. You know what I'm saying? He bought us food. And it was just like, man, this is crazy. And then we did photo shoots in the alleys in Hollywood right there. And then we went back to the hotel. And then he's all like, you guys want to get a quick drink? I was like, all right, yeah, sure. So now we're drinking Hennessy at the bar over at Hilton.
Holy shit.
And I'm like, hey, don't you have to do, like, you know, don't you have your label meeting? Like, you know, isn't there supposed to be media supposed to meet up with it? And he goes, let me tell you something. Media, you guys are more important to me. Mm-hmm. Because without you, I wouldn't be where I'm at.
Mm, right.
Yep.
You are my voice to the people.
Right.
Yeah.
There's no social media at this time.
Mm-hmm.
They rely on magazines, yep, articles, and shit, yep, like that. And I was like, wow. He says, them, they're just using me, and they probably won't even fuck with me.
Right.
Right now, my time is with you because you're my vibe, because you're going to keep me more alive, mm-hmm, to the people.
And more current.
Mm-hmm. I was like, wow. He says, so, want a drink?
And that's what I think a lot of people, when, especially the younger generation, when they watch this movie, like, there was no social media, you know?
Yeah. 'Cause
my kids always ask me, like, how do you know all this stuff about movies when they came out? It's because I would get the entertainment section of the newspaper every Sunday, because, yep, it was like four times bigger, and I would go through, read the articles, buy Entertainment Weekly, buy Premiere Magazine, get the Hollywood Reporter.
We actually had it to pay for information.
Yeah, you, yes, actually had to do, yes, research, yeah, versus like, oh, I wonder what's wrong with me. Let me Google it. Let me find out all the reasons why. You know what I mean?
You had to open the newspaper to see when the movie was playing, yeah, and at what time. And you better be there on time.
Exactly. Yeah. Or you'd be sitting, yeah, in the front fucking,
exactly,
row facing straight up.
It's so crazy. But yeah, I mean, this movie here, like I said, you know, I can relate to this whole film a lot. I saw, mm-hmm, myself a lot in this film.
Mm-hmm.
Like music, culture. So, anybody have a synopsis of this? Want to dive into it? I know.
Yeah, I got something here.
Go ahead.
So, set in 1973, the movie is a coming of age story for a 15-year-old high school prodigy student, William Miller. William, a neurotic rock and roll music fan inspired by bands of the time, somehow lands himself an assignment with Rolling Stone magazine to go on tour and interview the up and coming band Stillwater for a possible cover story. William embarks on an eye-opening journey of sex, drugs, groupies, and rock and roll, documenting the highs and lows of the music industry with the band as it tours across the country, despite the objections of his mother.
Wow. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. You're good at that, man.
Hey.
You're nice. That's your new job now.
All righty. I'm on it.
I like that.
You're hired.
You're hired. Right. You're hired. And remember, don't do drugs.
Yeah, exactly. Don't do drugs. Use the family whistle.
A friend of mine brought this over and was like, you got to watch this movie on DVD. And I watched the DVD, and because he knew I was just getting into the music scene. And he's like, oh, I think this would really connect with you. And he was right. It did. And like I said, it taught me a lot about being in a band, you know, going on tour, doing music, meeting people. And I looked at it when this movie came out from through the eyes of a 15-year-old who was just getting exposed to this lifestyle. And then as I got older, I looked at it in reverse as the musicians in the group. So that just, it does really resonate with me still. I haven't watched it in years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, watched it three times this week. So
I know you don't like the sports correlations, but,
well,
something related both to me is, like William, myself, I was a younger guy trying to play sports against guys that were older than me. I was
more experienced.
I was about a year and a half behind age-wise, like William was, in people with you know, so I was 16 years old as a senior when people are turning 18, right? Like my girlfriend in high school, she was like 18 years old and going to clubs and all that other stuff. I was still 16-year-old senior, barely turning 17 when I graduated. So I think that's one of the things William is relatable to me with, is having to deal with, I was lucky enough to be a good athlete and be just as good as, or if not better than everybody else. But being on that younger side when everybody else is getting older and I'm still developing those early pubes.
How old were you when you got your facial hair?
I'm still working on it.
Fuck, I was like, I think I was in sixth grade.
I think.
Yeah, I came over about 17 or 18 finally when it started to pop over.
Yeah, wow. I was about the same.
It's just, I think he's a good casting choice for the kid.
Oh, yes.
He's got that innocent look still.
He did, yeah.
I mean, I think even now he's, what, 30-something years old? He still looks pretty young to me.
He's still working, too.
Yeah, he still does some stuff. I mean, that's going to fall into one of our categories, believe.
Oh. I already see your eyes, Chris.
Let me ask you guys this, though. Like, so with Chris, with your music, and I think you kind of tapped on this, too, with our last podcast. If you have not listened to our last podcast, be sure to go and check it out on all platforms. How was your mom? As growing up, was she micromanaging or trying to hold you back because of her experiences and what she went through in life, or did she just let you be? And then I want to kind of get Lobo's perspective on that,
musically or just in general.
Oh, well, I would say in general, because even in this film, the mom didn't really, like, she sheltered a lot, you know, and until like he actually started doing what he wants to do.
Yeah.
And then she finally was like, damn, I gotta let this kid.
You know, she is in this movie, the mother is very domineering, but she does trust him.
Yes.
Yes.
And she trusted him enough to make
more than her daughter.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's a good reason why they left that in the movie. Like, it's a good contrast between the way she treated the sister and the way she treated the son.
Yeah.
So she does have a lot of trust for William in the movie. You know, I mean, when I was in the music, when I got into the music industry, I was already, I don't even know. I was in my 20s. And by that point, I had already had three kids. So,
yeah.
You know, my mom was.
How about really just in general, like as a kid? Like,
I mean, in general, I think she was pretty lenient because. It was I'm coming from a single parent home, so she knew, like, well, I can't really teach him much about most things, so he kind of has to learn. He kind of has to learn from his friends. He kind of has to stumble and fall and learn to pick yourself up, which most parents do already in general. I think she was not domineering. I think she was pretty open. But then again, just like this kid, even to this day, me being 44 years old, I know what my mother does and doesn't like. So, like, that was ingrained into me. That was built into me. Just like this kid in the movie, like, he knows he shouldn't be doing drugs, so he's not going to do drugs. Like, he knows what his... It's like his mother is always looming over him throughout the entire movie, which does, you know, guide him in the right direction, like, to make the right choices.
Right.
I mean, it's basically a true story. Look where the guy is now.
Yeah.
Like, how many Academy Awards has he won?
True.
Exactly.
I mean, she was, you know, when she had to be, she was ruthless. I mean, the part where on the phone with Russell.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's touching one of my categories there. I think that's probably one of the best scenes because Russell just does not even know. Even when they're praying before they go on stage, he's like, he's looking down and he's completely out of it. Like, he's not even in the prayer because he's like, what did this lady just tell me? And it's still, like, resonating with him.
What did he say? Your mom fucked me up?
Your mom fucking freaked me out.
Yeah. That scene was great. But, yeah, we'll probably tap into that a little bit later. What about you? How was your mom?
A little bit different than that. So, I grew up playing sports my entire life. And, you know, my mom was the one that was at every single practice. So she never missed a practice. So I ended up going to a private school, and I lived with my grandparents in L.A., in the L.A. area, so in Whittier. So I used to live with them, and, you know, and it was kind of that thing. I'd been back a couple of times as I got older as well. But once I left at about 15, like, I was pretty much out of the house. And then I'd only come home and move back for like 3 months at a time or something. The next thing would open up and I move on to that. So I didn't have as controlling of a mom, but it's that let go that is in the movie where his mom actually trusts him and lets him go. Mm-hmm. I can relate to that part.
And I think we can relate to that being parents.
Absolutely.
Like you have to, you know, I mean, you know, your daughter lives out of
my
state.
My daughter lives in Denver.
Your son lives out of state.
My son lives in Oklahoma.
When they went to college or when they went off on their careers, like, you
gotta
know.
Let him go.
You got to, even like some, you know, my daughter Samantha, she graduated, you know, in New York. And
right. Yep.
Man, there's nothing harder than jumping on that plane to come back to California. But you just got to do it. Like, that's just part of life.
There's nothing harder than, and it's actually something I talk about maybe a little bit later. I have in my notes. The scene at the end of the movie where the sister and the mom come back together is a very relatable scene to me with my kids.
Wow. Me too. So, like, I forgive you. She's like, I didn't apologize.
It's such a great scene too.
Yeah, it is.
I would say for myself, my mom was always like feeding us to just be who we were, but at the same time, like, we would, you know, I would say my relationship with mom at times was kind of like how the daughter and mom are in this film. I don't know if you guys know, I'm a kind of a weird person.
No.
Yeah. Hence the name Wackoe. But I was always doing weird shit. I was like you know how you had G.I. Joe's, Transformers and shit, right? Well, I wasn't playing G.I. Joe's, Transformers. I gave them character names and I would make a scene and I was playing a movie with these characters.
Yeah, that's cool.
Like, you know, love interest, all that shit, dude. And then I would leave it and walk away. And then when I would come back, I would finish off what I was doing.
Oh, okay.
Like, everyone was a
kid. That explains a lot. That explains so much.
I was an interesting, you know, kid, you know what I mean? But I think where I started, like, as a teen, I was wanting to more find myself, and then after I graduated high school, it was like that's where I fell into the whole thing of, like, you know, the arts and shit, like, you know, the music. And then, like, 2 years later, I was working with a magazine. Like, it's like, well, how are you gonna make money off that? Well, first off, mom, I'm getting paid. When you said, are you making money with this? Are you getting so I am now, mom, check it out. Hey,
that's good.
But that time, like, yeah, you're right, like, there wasn't, like, you know, it was a different thing because you know, they came up from working their butts off, getting up, you know, going to work, coming home, putting food on the table, shit like that. There was times where that's how I learned how to cook, because, you know, she had to have a job and my dad had a job. A latchkey kid. I came home, made food for my brothers and stuff, and then that's just the way it was. But, like, she was always worried because, you know, oh, well, why are you doing this? Or what is this? How are you making money this? Well, why are you going there? Oh, well, we're going to go up to Utah and snowboard up there. And then they're going to give us some money so we can put the artists together. And all we got to do is bring these artists up there. And it's like, well, why? Why? So there was always that why and never that trust. You know what I mean? She was a big part of, like, you know, getting where I'm at. But my dad was the other half. And, you know, I was lucky to have him around. He was a very quiet man, didn't say much, you know. Not a man who said, like, love you. Hey, good job, son, because he never did that. That just wasn't him. I think that was Vietnam.
Yeah, maybe so.
Yeah. But his thing was like, well, are you going to get paid? Like, yeah, probably, yeah, but if not, I'll probably get something out of it. Well, all right.
Well, I mean,
that was it. Yeah. That was it.
Again, like, me and Gabe, I'm pretty sure can relate. It's like your biggest worry for your kid is, like, are they going to be able to take care of themselves?
Are you going to be okay?
Yeah.
Are you going to be okay? Because that's the thing, though. You know, I think it with anybody, too, especially as a parent, though, for sure. You guys have that. It's just like, you know, you're sending someone to the wild. But the thing is, though, is that, yo, I know those lions. I ran into those lions out there. I'm just one. Just, you're going to be, when you see the lion, you're going to be okay, right? You know to run or you know to fight back, right? Like,
or to outsmart them.
Right. You know what I mean? It's just, you guys been out in the wild. You've been in the jungle. You know? And then me as a kid, too, my parents, you know, they say, well, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, oh, okay, yeah, whatever. Oh, yeah, whatever.
Because they've
been in the jungle. And then now it's like, oh, shit, yeah, that's right. I remember that one time when my fucking dad told me this or my mom told me this shit. Yeah, it's like, son of a bitch.
It's so cliche. Like, you know, I 100 times I'm like, God damn, man, my mom was right.
Yeah.
Damn.
When my kids turn 30 or 40, they're gonna
say the same thing. About you.
And it never ends though, right?
No,
it's just this vicious cycle that just keeps going. And that's
life, though.
It is life, but then at the same time, it's like, are we really learning? Are we, like, you know what I mean? Like, we're trying to pass information down, but we block it, but we're not. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but I think if you learned 100%, it would be boring.
True.
You're always learning. I mean, that's life, right?
But it's true. You're always learning.
Yeah. Always getting better. Always evolving. So.
Who knew that this movie would pull out so many deep thoughts?
That's what we do here, baby. That's what we do here.
We have to start charging like $50 an hour for this session.
Yeah. Oh, I know. Everybody over there at home listening or in your car and stuff, they're like, oh my God, damn.
Yeah, maybe we should take a break and get into Act One here.
Everybody's like, let me call my parents right now.
Exactly.
Pause his mom. All right, we're going to do that. We'll go ahead and take a quick break right here, and then we'll come back, and we're going to get started with this with Act One.
Don't take drugs!
So as many do know or don't know, since we only have one podcast that popped out, we go through different acts. This is Act One, and we have different categories, so we just tap into these different categories and kind of express our opinions and thoughts on these categories and just having some fun. So, you know, what was the first thing that came to mind when you guys thought of this movie? I want to go ahead and just pop it out real quick.
Go ahead, because I had to write multiple in case
oh my god, I don't know. I don't want to step on your toes.
Nope, go for it.
No, go ahead.
I've got a couple myself.
All right, cool. Great. Because the one thing that really popped out on me on this thing here, you know, it's probably one of your little boners, Penny Lane.
Yes. I have Kate Hudson on the first line.
Yeah. Is that the same one?
Well, yeah.
All right. Wow. But so not only, obviously, she's great. She's beautiful in this and stuff like that, though. But I've met Penny Lanes in my life. Mm. Like, I've met, like,
Band-Aids.
Yes. It's interesting, and some of these people, they were just like friends. Like, I've never really hooked up with them, right? But they were like really tight friends,
sure.
You know, especially like during the era where I used to go to clubs and stuff like that. Like, a lot of my friends were females, and they were like Penny Lanes, and like you could just conversate with them and just the way they saw life, and then they just made me kind of think outside the box a lot, if that makes any sense.
So they were hippies.
They weren't hippies, but they're...
They opened your mind, though, slightly.
Yeah. No, because they were clubbers. They're all different personalities. So they weren't, like, hippies. Don't, you know, like, I don't want to kind the people here trying to picture this. Hey, man, far out. Oh, Wackoe. Like, no. Like, you know, they're just different types of, you know, Penny Lanes, man, you know? Mm-hmm. But she stood out to me, and I'm just like, damn, I know. That reminded me of so-and-so. That reminded me of so-and-so.
Yeah.
Like,
well, he did say that Penny Lane is, like, an amalgam of multiple people that he met during his exploits on the road with Rolling Stones.
There you go.
He pretty much just took bits and pieces of everyone and merged them together into this one perfect character.
Sure.
Yeah. You know? So let me ask you before we tap in yours, because I don't want to sit on this too long. Mm. Do you guys remember any of your Penny Lanes?
Mm.
Or have you came across a Penny Lane of yours?
Yeah, I have. And I think that's what it is following up on what you're saying. It's the reason why I'm drawn to her. It's because of the way she talks to William. It's like she's, and the way she looks at him, it's like looking into his soul, right? Mm-hmm. And then trying to help him be the best that he could be. And so there's a couple of people that I know, both male and female, that really make me feel that same way, that they're trying to make me be the best version of myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why I'm drawn to that Penny Lane character.
It's very hard to meet someone like how you just mentioned, I think, in the music industry, because the music industry is so cutthroat.
Yes.
So a lot of
times... The entertainment industry is just pretty much cutthroat.
Oh, yeah, completely. So you have to have your armor on. You got to, like... You got to keep your head down. You got to keep pushing forward. If this movie was made in the 80s or in the 70s, like, her mother would be like the perfect person to be cast, because they have the same look. They got that same glint in their eyes. Like, they look exactly the same.
Yeah.
You know, I think so.
Yeah.
You know, you could put this, I mean, it does take place in the 70s. If it was, you know, a contemporary piece made in the 70s about the 70s, you know, Goldie Hawn is like the perfect choice to be Penny Lane.
That same carefree style.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Barefoot in the Park was a movie where she has that same style, just very carefree. Or
Kate Hudson?
But it's Goldie Hawn.
Really?
Yeah, she was in Barefoot in the Park, and it was a play that was turned into a movie, and it's ultimately, she's basically in her underwear the entire movie, but she just moves around very similar to how Kate Hudson moves around in this movie.
I wonder if she studied that, like, movies with her mother in it to kind of...
I don't... Or maybe she just got it just because it's her mom. Good just genes. That genes.
Well, her like dad's Kurt Russell, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because, like, when you see Kate Hudson, it's just like, dude, it's like your mom. And when you watch your mom's films, it's like, you know, it's just like, dude, like...
It's meant to happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like, definitely. It's just... I think it's just Goldie Hawn just... reincarnated him.
Sure.
So do you guys both have the same
that was the first thing that popped up.
It was Kate Hudson for me as well.
Yes. I mean, I have multiple standout moments.
Out of those multiple, let's pick one of those ones.
So the most influential part for me is going to be anything with Lester Bangs.
Yeah.
Because he's just
spitting knowledge.
Lester.
And it's Philip Seymour Hoffman is like amazing.
R.I.P.
Yeah. R.I.P.
Yeah, R.I.P. Man. Yep.
You know what? To tap onto Lester, I think one of the scenes that like really stands out for me. I don't know if we're tapping into a category with this, but at the record shop the radio station.
The beginning.
Yeah, in the beginning, and just how like she was saying, "Oh, isn't it a little too early for that?" For some Iggy Pop.
Yeah, for me.
Not for me, but it's so true though. But because me working also in radio right now too, right? Mm-hmm. The stations are like, they're set to a standard of like what should be played.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just funny that in that scene, and then when it popped, I was just like, fuck, it's so fucking true.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Like they do have.
She's like, don't stray away from.
Right. There is a time frame of how music should be played and laid out throughout the day. Like for whoever does listen to radio, like that, it's set that way.
But he's just he's a wild man.
But yeah, just that whole scene though, and then when he was just saying what he said about the music and stuff like that and everything, and just
when he breaks it down,
I was just like, wow.
The Lester Bangs part when he's in the cafe at the beginning with William, and he's telling him like, you know, they're gonna buy you drinks, they're gonna offer you drugs, you know, and he's like, and they're gonna ruin everything, you know, about you.
Yeah.
Like those moments, everything he said meant so much to me that I used his dialogue in probably some of the earliest music that I ever created.
Oh, wow.
I put like Lester Bangs dialogue in my songs because it just resonated so much for me.
Yeah.
You know, and I was like, and as I'm going into the music industry, working in the music industry, I'm like, God damn, he's fucking right. Like, you know, Cameron Crowe's like a preacher, man. He's like, he's speaking the truth the whole movie.
Yeah.
You know, he never holds back.
Yeah.
Fucking nothing about you that is controversial, man. God, it's going to get ugly, man. They're going to buy you drinks. You're going to meet girls. They're going to try to fly you places for free, offer you drugs. And I know it sounds great, but these people are not your friends. You know, these are people who want you to write sanctimonious stories about the genius of rock stars, and they will ruin rock and roll and strangle everything we love about it. You know, because they're trying to buy respectability for a form that is gloriously and righteously dumb. You know, and you're smart enough to know that. And the day it ceases to be dumb is the day it ceases to be real. Right? And then it just becomes an industry of cool. I mean, I'm telling you, you're coming along at a very dangerous time for rock and roll. I mean, the war is over. They won. And 99% of what passes for rock and roll these days, silence is more compelling. And that's why I think you should just turn around, go back, you know, and be a lawyer or something. I can tell from your face that you won't.
Do you, one of the lines where he tells him where he meets Williams, I guess he says how like his classmates hates him.
Mm-hmm. They hate me.
Yeah. They hate me. And then he...
You're going to meet them all again on the long journey to the middle.
Yeah, I thought of Wackoe when an offline conversation that we had.
Which part? He's the Lester? Part,
yeah. No, that line of you're going to meet him back in the middle.
Yeah.
You're going to meet him back on your long journey to the middle.
You know, Wackoe talking about his high school reunion coming up, and so it made me think of you.
Yeah, because when he said that line, I was just, you're gonna meet him in the middle. And it's funny though, because
on the long journey,
because it is a long journey though. Mm-hmm. For sure,
it's a long way down,
right? But when we do meet in the middle, mm-hmm. I think the reality is we do find out, like, fuck, we're all really the same.
Sure. Oh yeah,
it was like all this whole shit was a bunch of bullshit. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think everybody's goal is to give them a high five while you're on the way up and they're on their way down.
Yeah, I love that part, man, that quote. So I thought that was kind of cool. Anything else on that, guys?
No, I mean, I have other, if you want me to do multiple, I could, but I think that's Lester Bangs hits the hardest for me.
Absolutely. No, I like that one. I like that one. And then Penny Lane.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Those are the two.
That hits the hardest.
So did you know?
Yeah.
Did you know?
That's
our next category.
Next category is Did You Know?
DreamWorks Picture.
Yeah, DreamWorks.
Released September 13th, 2000.
Mm-hmm.
Filmed in 92 days. So I wrote that down because I wanted to ask you guys about that. We talked about Deep Cover, how
40 days.
40 was it 40 days? Or was it 42?
40 around the 40s.
So this movie filmed in 92 days. Is that a quick film or is that plenty of time?
It's 3 months.
Yeah.
That's a good time frame, you know? I mean, look what Deep Cover did in just
40 days.
40 days.
Yeah.
In a month and what? 2 weeks, yeah, maybe,
like,
or something?
A month and a week or
something like that? Yeah.
I mean, I don't think that might be not out of the ordinary, but maybe for. So DreamWorks at the time was almost like an independent company that was ran by Spielberg. Yeah. So if you're doing a studio production, I want to say 92 days is a very long time, but. If you're doing an independent film, technically.
I think that's a lot of playroom.
Oh, yeah.
That's a lot of playroom. And because the scenes, I mean, the different sequences in the movie. Mm-hmm. I mean, like what we're looking right now. I am a golden god.
Yep.
So Spielberg just starts DreamWorks. I think one of the first movies he did was, Shrek, probably. Shrek. You know, Shrek 1 and 2. And, well, of course, it's Cameron Crowe. He's got a long list. He's got a long resume leading up into Almost Famous. He gives the script to Spielberg.
Uh-huh.
Spielberg reads it over the weekend. Monday morning, he's like, you have to do this, and you have to film every page. Like, that doesn't happen.
Wow.
You know, so, I mean, that's somebody Spielberg really had his back. And it's funny that Spielberg has been in the business since, what year was Jaws?
76 or 77.
Yeah. So he's been in the business 45 plus years, and only now is he making his memoir, his autobiographical movie, which was The Fablemans.
The Fablemans, yes.
And this is Cameron Crowe. He makes this movie in, what year did you say, 2003?
This is 2000.
2000. So, you know, he had been only in the movie business.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy though how long it took Spielberg just to let it out.
He's, you know, without going on a tangent, he's dropped pieces of that movie in every single one of his movies leading up to.
Well, E.T. was another kind of a little piece of himself in that film, mm-hmm. especially because the mom, the dad leaving, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. everything like that. Yeah,
like so, there's always a father,
right,
problem in every movie.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. I got one.
Go for it.
Cameron Crowe's ex-wife. Mm. She did composed a lot of the music and stuff.
And you took mine.
Well,
you beat me to it.
Well, no, I want to. I'm the quarterback.
Go for it.
And I want to hand it off to Nancy Wilson. I want to just hand the rock to you because this is like your expertise right here, brother.
I hope I don't fumble the ball here.
There you go. You got it right.
Oh, good job. Right. Yeah.
Look at that guy.
So Nancy Wilson is half of. Heart. Everybody knows who Heart is.
Well, some.
And that's all I have on that.
Well, she co-wrote three of the songs.
Yes, co-wrote
for Stillwater.
Yeah, for Stillwater.
Right,
which,
right.
Which, I guess, they're original songs.
They are
original.
None
of them are up for songs. Oscar nomination as an original song.
Do you think...
Wasn't Peter Frampton also in...
Yeah, Peter Frampton actually taught Billy Crudup how to play guitar and sing.
Yeah.
You know... And this will be in a category that I'll touch base on, do any of those songs feel like they need to be Oscar worthy? And that's just me. I don't think so. But that's just my personal.
I mean, I'm just thinking about the recent Oscar songs that are coming out, and I'm just like, I don't know. These were better, I feel like, than some
really?
Of those.
Come on,
I
man.
Do. Yes.
Oh my God, Lady Gaga, man. I'm not a Gaga fan, but I think she killed it with that.
Oh, she did, absolutely.
That's the only one I want to say
for
Maverick.
For Maverick. I mean, I was like Shallow on that one.
Let's not get
that's
off on a
whole
tangent
other,
on that.
That's a whole know, other that's podcast right there, folks. Right.
I do have one other one before we move on to the next one.
Oh, yeah. I have a bunch, actually.
Well, Brad Pitt was originally the Russell Hammond character and was replaced because they said it wasn't working out.
I agree because at that point, I think it becomes a Brad Pitt vehicle.
Sure.
Yeah, he'll take away from everybody. He'll take too much of the sunshine, you know what I mean?
Yeah. William is like Billy, what's his name? Patrick Fugit is just the perfect choice for this.
Absolutely.
I think so too. His look, just what he brought to the table, it just fits well. I think Brad Pitt would have just been way too much. Like, mm-hmm. It would have been too much.
Speaking on the music, I did look to see if that was really Jason Lee singing, and I couldn't find
it
anything.
It isn't.
Not him?
No, it's not him.
Oh.
I want to say when I was looking, it might have been one of the backup singers for Heart.
Because I'm looking, I'm like, man,
I could be
really
wrong about that, but it was a backup singer that contributed a lot to the music, and that was a person that was singing, and he was lip syncing over that.
Okay, because I was like, he's doing. I mean, so there was a couple of other choices for Penny Lane.
Ooh,
Christina Ricci.
Yep,
Christina Ricci.
Toni Collette.
Mm-hmm.
And originally cast was Sarah Polley, who just won Academy Award this past year.
That's right.
Would those three ladies have completely changed your perception of Penny Lane? I think she would have embodied a more motherly character with those ladies. I don't know. Because, Kate Hudson's very angelic. It's like she's almost like a painting.
Well, Toni Collette, I think, would have had that same style. I think Toni Collette would have had the same style, but she's a little bit more erratic.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, when I think of her.
Mm-hmm. I just think that, like, Kate Hudson can just like, it's like she's just like tiptoeing.
She's over very sparse.
Yeah.
But like, very, she knows what she's given.
Yes.
She's very confident in what she's given.
Yes. So like, I think it would have changed a lot.
Also, Uma Thurman was supposed to be Penny Lane as well.
Well, I have a Natalie Portman through some research was a potential Penny Lane.
That one might have been pretty good. But I think Natalie Portman's almost too perfect, like she's very, very pristine.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Yeah, I don't see.
And I think she's still in the middle of trying to get the Star Wars. She's episode 2. It only came out, so she was still. Everybody's looking at her still Queen Amidala.
Yeah. True. Definitely.
And did you know that there's an Almost Famous on Broadway right
now? Yeah,
there's a musical.
I did not know
there's
that.
A musical.
Mm-hmm. There is a musical.
No way.
And as the pandemic's kind of let up, Cameron Crowe is. Visited everybody one by one and invited them to, do their role again on the stage show, like Jimmy Fallon, Billy Crudup. Like, he's invited all those people to kind of do a show or two as the character they portrayed in the film.
Wow.
Yeah, so that is that's pretty interesting. I don't know if I would enjoy it quite the same, but
I got one more add on there too.
Sure.
For did you know?
Sure.
Did you know that Sapphire, the character Sapphire.
Mm-hmm.
I always say her name wrong. If you guys help me out,
is it a
Farrah
Balk?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
The
Craft.
Yes, The Craft.
Return to Oz.
You know, Waterboy.
Yeah.
Yada yada yada.
Ever seen it? Sorry,
you're missing out.
You're missing out.
Did you know that she almost ran me over in Hollywood?
What?
Wow, I don't think she even knows.
Oh no, she knew because she slammed the brakes and literally my hand was on top of the car and Phys Ed.
Oh, you were walking.
Yes, and Phys Ed and we both looked at her and I was like, "What the fuck?" And then she was just looking like, "Oh my god, I'm so sorry. Oh my god, are you okay?" I'm like, "Bitch." and then when I finally came to sense, when this anger just turned off,
like,
and
oh my god,
I'm like, no, it's cool, it's cool. And then she's like, oh, are you sure? Are you sure? I'm like, no, we're cool, we're cool, cool. And you could tell she was just like, fuck, I almost just fucked up. Like, wow. You know?
So,
and then she just drove off and she rolled down the window and she's, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. And then she drove off and then I turned over and I said, do you know who fucking almost killed us right now?
And is this post or pre almost famous?
No, this was, I don't know, maybe 2008, nine or something like that, maybe. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wow, so this podcast could almost have not been happening.
Right?
Yeah.
Right? Just thought I'd like.
Too bad we can't get her on to talk about it.
Talk about that.
You owe me. You almost killed me on this podcast.
You almost killed me.
How about some of this cast and crew?
Yes.
I guess earlier what we were talking about earlier, pretty much everyone here was almost famous.
Yeah.
On this podcast?
No, I'm talking about the movie.
Oh, gotcha.
I mean, yes. You know, I could be a little bit famous. No.
You're most famous.
I'm most famous. Anyways, but in this film, though, like pretty much everybody here it's a fat lineup if you really think about it.
Yeah,
like,
totally.
And then where everyone is now, I mean, there's so many people. I don't want to go through the whole list because there's so many people. But like, yeah, like in this film, it's like, dang, you're almost famous, literally, like, you know?
Well, I mean, you got Cameron Crowe. Like, sorry, everybody. I've never seen Jerry Maguire. I've never seen... Say Anything. I've never seen Singles. I have seen Vanilla Sky because I like those weird movies. Yep. But
Chris, you like only weird movies.
Yeah, I know. And maybe that's why. Maybe his movies were too mainstream. I don't know. I've just never. I'm not a huge Cameron Crowe fan, but if you consider my affinity for this film as a ranking for him, like I guess I do like Cameron Crowe, but sorry.
It's all right, man. Well, this is the fun part of this podcast is we're going to make you watch some of these films.
So the cast is stacked.
It is.
What do you guys think, and I think especially Wackoe, about the director of photography? What do you think?
As far as how he attacked the film? In general?
It's very subtle, yes?
It is, though, because I mean...
Like, there's no hard lighting, there's no crazy angles, no crazy lenses.
No, there's not much to it. I think what's most important here is that, like, with the director of photography really brought the attention to these characters.
Yeah, so if they would have had a different DP, would that have taken away from the story they're trying to tell?
It could have.
Like a more stylized look.
Right. The look, and then, you know, just... these characters are so important to this story. Each person is bringing a certain, you know... level to the game, and
they stand out. Everybody, every time they're on screen, they're never. No one's stealing the spotlight.
No. And that's what's so great about this film. It's like no one is, just like you said, no one's stealing anything for nobody. Mm-hmm. Everyone's kind of letting them do their thing and breathe. Mm-hmm. Like, and that's what's so beautiful about this film.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, question to you guys: why aren't they a bigger star? Who is it? What you guys got?
I got Patrick Fugit.
So do I.
Oh, I got Billy.
Really?
Okay.
I don't think, I mean,
he has done some stuff, but
He's done some stuff, though.
He's electric in this movie.
Yeah.
And I do, like, how come his next one wasn't?
Exactly. That's, you know. I mean, he has the looks.
He was Dr. Manhattan in The Watchmen.
Well, I mean, yeah, but, it's, you know.
That's about it. I know he was the bad guy in Mission Impossible 3.
Yeah, I just he has a good
Philip Seymour Hoffman also.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's weird.
Yeah, that's why I picked Bill. I was like, well, how come he hadn't been, he could have done a lot of lead roles and stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. He's a good looking guy, you know. I don't think he really had a powerful lead role
and never really dipped into it.
Supporting role in Big Fish.
Yeah, see?
You know, supporting role in... He's in The Morning Show, Apple
TV. Oh, yeah, that's the new big one right now.
That's the new one, yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, Fugit, he's... I mean, I know he's been steadily working, but there's nothing I could say like, oh, man, that's the guy from Almost Famous. But I did say that in Gone Girl because he's like one of the cops. But that's the only time I've been like, oh, my God, that's the kid from Almost Famous. And he grew up.
I think I caught that same moment, though, when he was in We Bought a Zoo, the Matt Damon film, and he was in the background
and
on that
one. That's also Cameron Crowe.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. It is.
Yeah.
It is a
Cameron Crowe. Oh, yeah. That's right. Yeah, because he worked with him like two or three times or something like that.
And I just remember with Cameron Crowe, he did that. I think the last movie he did was Aloha.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the one that got that huge backlash because he cast Emma Stone as like a Polynesian woman.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
She's like Snow White white.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like that doesn't.
Like Sleeping Beauty white, you know?
Yeah. That's like putting Lou Diamond Phillips as Richie Valens.
Dude. Don't jinx us, but that could potentially be our next podcast.
I'm looking forward to it, so let's not tap into that.
What's the best part of this movie?
Oh, can I tap into this real quick?
Yeah, because I've already spoiled mine anyways.
All right, so I would say for me, like, the best part of this film, and it is kind of maybe going a little bit more into one of our other categories, I think, but the best part of this film for me is the Stillwater performance when they're like going to take on the stage. That first time we see them taking on the stage.
With the prayer and stuff.
The prayer.
And I relate to that.
That's the reason why. Because so I like, for me, I've seen that. And mm-hmm. me being able to be around these certain types of people. Mm-hmm. And then also just access of where I get to. I like to observe the behind the scenes aspect of things. Mm-hmm. And like, seeing that really brought me to certain moments that I've gotten to see that. Like, for instance, Slipknot. You know, I mean, I got drunk with these guys after their show, but I got to see them come together. They did a little prayer thing, and then just the lights churning down, and you're hearing the crowd, and you just see them just kind of just like, you know, mentally getting prepared for themselves. Mm-hmm. There's certain things that are going through. That whole scene there is just like, wow, I've seen that. And and I love that scene. And I kind of wanted to see more of it. I want to see more of the performance.
You know,
I just wanted more of that to kind of just say that, like, oh, wow, this is a great band.
It's true. Like how you said, it's a true thing that, like, we used to pray before every performance. And I'm not a religious person, but it was like superstitious, like, the first time we prayed, we had a really good show.
Sure.
So if I don't do it the second time, I'm probably not going to have a good show.
Yeah.
So that just became
a thing. It just became a thing, yeah.
Every show, let's pray, you know, and one person please lead the prayer, same thing. So yeah, that lot of those things kind of
And another thing that I liked about that is when Penny takes the pencil away from the enemy, it basically like, just sit and watch.
Yeah, take it all in.
Take it in. And that's what I've gotten experience where, like, I just kind of just stop for that moment, whatever I'm supposed to be doing at these shows, and just soak that in and just be able to just to see that moment. Because that's a moment that these people get to experience, you know, once in a while. But it's like a unique experience. And that's why I wanted to get your perspective on that, you know. Mm-hmm. But I love that scene. That's probably one of my favorite scenes.
Mine is the bus scene.
The tiny dancer.
Oh my
God. You guys are killing me.
When it plays in the background.
What? It's like the same ones.
Yes. And it comes up and then, you know, they just come back together as a family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The jump cuts hitting every single character, including the bus. Yeah. They hit the bus even.
Because the bus is
a character for them.
What's the bus's name? Doris or?
Doris. I think it's Doris.
Doris, right? Yeah.
It's funny.
I get goosebumps every single time. I'm thinking about it right now. I got goosebumps because I love that scene so much.
And it also goes to show how in your life that there's certain music that when you hear it, every single time you think about.
Yep.
And it's like those guys, every time they hear Tiny Dancer, and that's what they said in that behind the scenes interview. Every time Tiny Dancer comes on, like they think of that moment.
Yeah.
Like those 2 days filming that scene.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, Chris, those were the ones that you hit?
Yeah, I give up.
Oh, all right. Well, what were they thinking?
Yes.
That's their next category here.
Go ahead, Chris.
Chris, why don't we go ahead and let you go on this one?
What were they thinking? I mean, I think my biggest question to whoever is involved, probably Cameron Crowe, is why not just make it a straight autobiographical piece? Like, I mean, why not? Let's give it a shot. You know, I mean, make it all completely just about him versus like, we know it's like the Allman Brothers band, but a lot of it's like experiences that he had with different groups. He kind of just like pushed them all together.
Yeah.
That's my question. You know, why not just make it autobiographical completely 100%?
Yeah, I agree. I agree with that one. Yeah.
Mine is, I actually have a couple, but the main one that I've got is for the casting director, Gail Levin. Like, how does she find all of these almost famous stars and bring them all together? I mean, like, it's a great cast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they all do some really good stuff mm-hmm. after this movie. But at the time, they weren't stars at the times.
So. Yeah, she must have had a hell of an eye.
Yeah.
But I guess that's why they do what they do.
Yeah.
My, what were you thinking maybe pertains not so much. It didn't really age well, obviously. But 16, 18-year-olds just tagging along with you.
Wait, say that again? Say that again?
16 to 18-year-olds uh-huh. just tagging along with you and tour and having sex.
Oh, dude. And that's the other thing that's weird, too, is when they're in the bus and the bass player's like, oh, man, there's a line of, like, high school girls.
Yes.
Running.
I'm like, yes.
Dude, that's just, I mean, it was wrong. Let's just say this is the 70s. It's wrong then. It's, like, really wrong now.
Absolutely.
Like, yeah, so you know, like, so that's probably a couple things that didn't age well.
What were you
well,
thinking? Sure. Putting that in there. Yeah. What were you thinking?
Maybe that's a part of the director's cut.
Yeah.
On the cutting room floor.
Okay.
The next level.
Next level.
What is needed to, like, take this to the next level? I really didn't have anything for this, to be honest.
I did.
Well,
did you have anything?
You know, this one was a personal thing for me.
Same.
I mean, with it being in the 70s, mm-hmm. We were talking about it earlier about, you know, some of the influences that we had, and I would have loved to have heard like a CCR song in there.
Mm. The needle drops.
Yes. Yeah. I would have loved to have heard a Carpenters for my mom, right? Is that Carpenters? Mm. I know like every fucking Carpenters song.
So that would have brought it to
that
the next
would have
level.
Brought it to the next level for me, is to be able to hear that Carpenter song in the background at some, you know, at some point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like maybe a wider variety of those music.
So sure. You know, you expect to hear a little bit more of those classics or something like that. You know?
Yeah, I would love to have heard that Carpenters.
I got one also.
Go.
I'm probably in the minority between you guys. I think that they needed to, how do I say this? So the actors that played Stillwater, I don't think they were very good. Like, I think they needed more practice. Like, I watched, you know, and this is me being a musician, because I can't even go to a live performance now. Because I'm always, like, looking at what they're playing, looking at their presence, looking at their setup, looking at their sound, hearing what they sound like. To me, they weren't convincing. And that's
really
just me.
Because they trained them as a band.
I know, they trained them as a band. Mm-hmm. But I do believe, you know, you can practice and practice and practice, but not until you do a real gig and have gigged it and gigged it and gigged it and fucked up and fucked up and fucked up, do you really learn how to become a band.
Yeah.
You know, so that's, for me, that's the only thing that wasn't believable. I think, I mean, you know, hey, if they were to redo the movie, maybe put them out on the road for, you know, 6 weeks and have them really get some gigs under their belt, you know?
I think they did that in that movie, That Thing You Do. I think
the band did
a bit.
Yeah, they did.
That's pretty believable, that band.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. No, I agree with that. Yeah.
That's just me being picky.
Yeah.
No, but I mean, you know, it's okay. We already know you're a picky guy anyways.
Yep, that's me. All right. Touchdown.
No, Chris. That doesn't quite work right there, though. Interception, maybe, you know?
Yeah. All right, cool.
All right.
Fumble. I don't know.
All right. With so much to teach you.
It's
a little time. But what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and teach this guy. So we're going to take a break, and then we're going to go into Act 2.
Yep.
Honey, you're too sweet for rock and roll.
Sweet? Where do you get off? Where do you get sweet? I am dark and mysterious and pissed off, and I could be very dangerous to all of you. I am not sweet, and you should know that about me. I am the enemy.
All right, guys, here we go. Cutting room floor. All right, last time it was Gopher.
Yeah, I don't think we have a Gopher in this movie.
No, to me there is a Gopher in this movie.
Uh-oh. Really?
Wow. I mean, it's not annoying as what Gopher was, but...
So for the audience...
All right, sorry.
Cutting room floor is who can be completely edited out, who's disposable, who could have been removed from the storyline altogether, and did anybody deserve more screen time?
All right, and then for those who are the youngins, cutting room floor.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Didn't think about that.
Yeah. We got to remember. Mm-hmm. Okay. So cutting room floor, basically that term, and back in the days, everything was being edited on film. They would literally cut the film and piece it together.
Splice it together.
Yeah. Yep. and in it, whatever they did not use would drop on the floor. So it was in that's all that right. term. So
who's on the cutting room floor for you?
That fucking kid, Vic. Exactly.
Really? You didn't like Vic?
Which kid is Vic?
Vic. He's Vic. The, he was the kid
following Led Zeppelin around.
He followed
oh,
Led
Zeppelin. I love it.
I like that kid.
I thought he was good.
But is he really needed, though? Like, doesn't he have, like, school or something like that? This guy's just going all over the place.
Yeah, he's not needed. But at the end, he is the one that tells him where Penny lay and
the girls
are.
He's the one that brings him back up.
And I think
around.
If he would have just popped up, they would have been like, who the fuck's this guy?
Yeah, but anyone could have told him where fucking Penny's at.
Okay. But yeah, so Vic is actually based on a real person, which is why he's in there. But I feel you. I feel you.
Yeah, it's just like, you know, it's just weird. Like, you know, it's very stalkerish to me.
You got anybody needed more screen time? Lobo?
So, cutting room floor, I had actually Rainn Wilson. So this is pre-Office.
Take him out?
Take him out. Wow. I mean, he's one of the...
Cold sniper. Just take him out, huh?
I mean, he's one of the Rolling Stone reporters, but he's just in the background smoking cigarettes, you know, while...
So I think a way to approach this, too, is like, he didn't... So Rainn Wilson didn't annoy you. You just could have trimmed him for time.
Yeah. I mean, there was a couple of shots.
Or you wanted him out completely.
Yeah. I mean, he didn't annoy me. It's just like you're talking about for time.
Cut for time.
Yeah. Okay. He didn't do anything. He didn't really say anything. He made some hand gestures and things like that. Funny. But, you know, that's about it. And
what about who needed more screen time?
I think at that time, like, I want to see a little bit more Zooey Deschanel, you know?
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's because... Doing the research on the movie, there was a good relationship between William or Cameron Crowe and his sister, and that they didn't explore that enough. Like, she really introduced him to music. She introduced him to going to concerts, things like that. And so I would like to have seen a little bit more of that.
So, but do you think it would be more like something like where he would go back, like a flashback type thing? Because she's already gone.
She's gone, yeah.
I love the way it was set up, though, like, because you could tell that bond that they have, and then when she left the records and everything and listened to this with the candle and, like...
Yes.
Yeah, that was it was set up perfectly, though. But it might have been cool to kind of go back and just to, like you said, maybe a concert or something like that. That really, you know?
For sure.
She snuck him out to go see a concert.
Yep.
So,
all right. So mine, I'm reversed. So I thought you could have lost the sister, not completely. I think if you would have started as she's moving out, open the movie right there. She says one thing to him, shows him the records, and then that way she pops up again at the end of the movie.
Gotcha.
So I think you could have trimmed her. I don't think you should take her out. I think you could have trimmed her down. I wanted to see a little bit more of Jimmy Fallon.
Yeah, he was funny.
I thought maybe he could have pulled a little bit more more stuff off. He's like, you know, he's a pretty good he has a range and they didn't really use him, but he's really good in what he did.
Right now the plane scene. one of the iconic sequences in this film. You could have started there.
I think mine what I just mentioned with the sister, you could have started as she's being moved out of the house by the boyfriend and kind of go from there. I mean, only if you want to trim it for time. I think the theatrical is pushing 2 hours, and the director's cut is 2 hours and 42 minutes.
Yeah, it's like 39 more minutes or so.
And that's a funny thing. Like I saw the theatrical one time and found the director's cut, and I never watched another version after that. Only so recently.
Yeah, and I've seen the opposite. I think we talked about that. I've only really watched the theatrical version. I've seen the director's cut one time because I was kind of hitting you up on some of those extended scenes that I couldn't quite remember.
Yeah, and it's funny watching the theatrical. I'm like, man, there's so much missing.
Right.
But yeah.
Well, how about you? Anything?
I think the only thing I had was, you know, maybe start with William with his head down. I know that he was trying to show, Cameron's trying to show the controlling mom aspect a little bit more at the beginning.
When he was younger.
Yeah, when he was younger. But I think it could have started with him right in high school and kind of, you know, cut out that other part a little bit.
See, that would have made sense too. Like, you really didn't need, because you kind of learn his love of music throughout, even without leaving the albums. But it is a poignant scene, but if, like, a cut
it
for
it could have
time,
been a flashback or something to that.
True. But also, too, I mean, that was kind of like the whole setup of the, like, you're not really the age that you really think you are.
Sure.
True.
Sure.
And that kind of shows...
It takes that all away.
It takes that away, and that just shows how really smart the kid is, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So,
yeah.
All right. Extended cut or director's cut?
I'm all for the director's cut. Because I will sit there in a theater and watch a 3 hour plus movie because that's just how I am.
Yeah. Me too.
Is there something that you just want to just let it go a lot more, you know? For me, I think what I was tapping into earlier was just seeing that the band do a little bit more, mm-hmm. that performance and being at that concert, you know?
I got the same thing written down.
Yeah.
I agree.
I want to see the crowd. Let's do a cool wide shot. Just set it more to really just tell the story of this band of where they're going. Story should be told.
Yeah, when they cut to the lady and she's mouthing the Fever Dog song.
Yeah.
When she's up on top of the guy's shoulders. I would have loved to have seen a little bit more of that.
And maybe I'm just tainted watching this movie because when you're with a band, as long as you're with a band, you do become a family. And that's an aspect of the band. But the other major aspect, which is probably 65-75% of it, is when you're on the stage, that's a whole different type of unit. You know what the next person is going to do.
Yeah.
And maybe that's the part of the movie I didn't just buy because you never second guess, but I know where this guy is going. I know where this person's going. I know what's coming up next. I know that look. I know the way he's playing those drums. I know what he's about to do. That's a thing. That's the sixth sense that you establish.
Sure.
Yeah, definitely would like to see them play the whole song.
Yeah, me too.
I think it worked well for, I don't know. Are you into The Star Is Born?
I think we made him go see it, didn't?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. I think my wife, Jessica, saw Star Is Born.
Come on, dude. How many films have she seen that
I forced her to go see? I'm in a deficit.
Every single one, probably.
Last night, we're watching Licorice Pizza.
What did she think of it?
You know, she liked it.
It was a good film.
Oh, it's a fantastic film. But, you know, that's one of those movies you don't want to watch all the time. But,
I mean,
I'll watch it all the time.
Yeah. Well, we're a little different.
Yeah.
Act 3, Devil's Advocate.
Wow.
You can only save one.
Mm. Only one.
Only one.
Wow. I got some multiple choices.
Oh, you
do. You guys cut me out, but go ahead.
All right. You know what? Because we don't want to do this to you again. No, go ahead.
Because I think if I let you guys go first, it'll narrow down my choices.
All of a sudden now we're flipping. Yeah. All right.
Well, I got to go with Patrick Fugit on it. He's the guy that I think...
Has to stay.
He carried the entire movie. He was in every scene of the movie. So he's the guy that has to stay.
I agree. He's perfect, perfectly cast.
No, 15-year-old,
fresh face.
Yeah,
you know.
Well, one of them I had Kate Hudson. Okay. I just think she's the glue of everything.
I agree.
I she's definitely the glue, but I did write down Kate Hudson as well. You wouldn't get the same performance out of it, but I kind of thought. Could you get the...
Well, she's feeding these characters differently.
She is.
Each one, with her, so with Penny and Russell, just the shot when he says, oh, hey, this is... Almost, remember when they locked eyes backstage, Russell...
Oh, when he's introducing...
When he's introducing when they already kind of knew each other.
And if you would have... Penny Lane.
If you would have said, they had never met before...
Yeah.
You look at that scene, I'm like, that is called love at first sight.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
So that she's a big key element to this film. She really gives the feel to what people are projecting, putting into this film.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, true.
All right.
So since you guys covered my first two choices. All right. What else you got? I mean, you know, so the other one that I chose was...
Smart move.
Was Lester Bangs. Because he's such an important character to me personally. But I will say... I agree with Gabe because how many movies have you guys seen when it's a young actor and they are horrible and it's their first first performance? I mean, dude.
A lot.
Yeah. That's lightning striking.
Yeah.
You know, that's like Haley Joel Osment. That's one of the ones where he's a genius at a young age. But then you got the kid that played... was it Anakin Skywalker?
Oh my gosh!
Not Hayden Christensen talking about the young one. You know, but then you got the kid that played Elliot in E.T. Mm-hmm. You know, those don't happen all the time.
Yeah. No, they don't. They don't. You know? No. No, yeah. I agree with you guys.
So I say William, yeah. I'll go with William.
All right, here we guys go. Quantum Leap. Mm-hmm. So you guys are going to jump into somebody's
body
role in this film, and who would it be? Hmm.
I think single me would want to jump into Jeff.
I like how he said single me. You're not going to get in trouble. It's okay.
No, I don't.
We're
no.
in a safe space.
we're in a safe space yeah, that's going to be it's only, beamed all yeah. across yeah, it's the
just,
globe.
It's only just us three right yeah, here. Okay.
Millions eventually listening to us. But it would have been, I did put that one down as a joke, but I think it would go into Russell Hammond. I mean, if he truly loved Penny Lane, he would have never let her get away. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that would have been the guy I would have jumped into and fought for her. Mm-hmm. Even if she did reject him and he did try, but I would have not let anything stop me before then.
What about you, Chris?
I'd probably go into, I'd want to quantum leap into William to be able to experience like childhood all over again.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, you know, he's at 15, he is experiencing what most 30-year-olds couldn't experience in that lifestyle. So he's actually able to do some pretty amazing things, which makes sense. That's why he became, I guess, a pretty amazing director.
Sure.
Yeah.
But yeah, I definitely want to quantum leap into William.
Yeah.
Probably do everything exactly the same.
That's what I put down William. I just...
To be at the beginning of your game.
Yeah.
You know, like, but learning those tools sooner.
Yes.
You know?
All right. Who gets the Oscars?
I'm still going with Kate Hudson.
I'm on going this one. Kate.
Yeah.
I'm going with my boner.
Oh, God. For that, that's a whole new category in the Oscars.
That's it. Oh,
that'll be next year.
Should we incorporate that in the new category?
I say the kid. Yeah. Because, like I said, it's just, it's, you know, lightning striking being able to get someone with that caliber performance.
It's a rare hit.
Yeah.
It's a rare hit.
Right. Which is why I'm kind of curious he isn't a bigger star.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe he's just being selective.
True. Oh, maybe.
I think he's also a musician as well.
No.
So he learned, I think he learned how to play the guitar a little bit during this filming. Uh-huh. And he kind of carried that over. I think he does like a classical guitar now.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Look at
Very
that.
Very cool.
See? Suspension of disbelief. Mm-hmm. On a scale from 1 to 10, where does it rank?
For me, it's a 2. Just for the stupid practical things, like how did William and Penny Lane get to L.A. from San Diego that quick in that slow-ass car in the 70s?
Yeah.
And the mother was like, oh, he's just going to a school dance.
Yeah, is he
going
to be back in time?
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, that's being, you know, nitpicking. So I put it at a level 2. Like, that's kind of unbelievable.
All right.
Especially because the mother was such a watchdog, you know, with everything. Like, that's the only thing that really stood out to me.
Oh, okay.
I had. How does a kid have a foursome first time out the gate, man? You know, it's like, you know,
and you know, wild. I was like, that's... he said that was true.
Oh shit!
Yeah, so I heard that he lost his virginity.
And on the disc, his mother is in the room during the commentary.
Wow! All right, I didn't really get much on that one there.
Because you're in disbelief now.
I'm in disbelief right now. I'm just like, damn. Where do we go from here? I don't know. I say like, well, what? Penny and William, 10 years later, where they're at.
Yeah, like what they're doing now.
What they're doing now. I'm curious where the hell Penny went. Like, after Morocco, did she really go to Morocco?
I don't see a sequel on this one. I don't want to see a sequel for this one.
Right, it's too perfect.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
I mean, I think, you know, if you were... If the studio is like, it's so successful, we have to do a sequel.
Oh, what they always do, you mean?
Yeah, what they always do, like before the movie comes out.
Yeah.
It'd be interesting to see, you know, William get into Hollywood like how Cameron Crowe did.
Sure.
You know, I think that would be interesting. I don't think it's a story you need to see, but if you were to do something, it's real life. Might as well just see what happens.
All right.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure the cast of characters in Hollywood are way more crazy than the musicians.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Tyler Durden.
Yes.
All right. My Tyler Durden-ness is Lester.
Lester.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah. Really? I thought you would have been on that too. I thought this would have been unanimous.
I thought it was going to be 3 for 3 on that one.
Wow. I say Penny Lane.
Wow.
Oh.
You know, they could make Penny Lane the Tyler Durden character and have Russell, you know, love one of the other girls instead of her.
Uh-huh.
And then she's just kind of there, like, overseeing, like, kind of narrating what's going on. And that's just me.
I like that. I like that.
Yeah, Lester Banks. I can see Lester also.
Yeah, because Lester's, when you really see, like, even though he is in the radio station, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean,
you could see him not be there.
You could still see him not being there.
Yeah.
And then you could have taken that, it out. And
he's always just on the phone.
Yeah.
He's like, he's,
I see that'd been good, man.
That's what I'm saying. He's
could rewrite it and
just
have him always the guy he's talking to on the telephone.
Yeah. He's the one that keeps him going when he's done.
Yeah. When he's down.
Yeah. Especially when he's down.
It's just like, cause his conscience being his guy. He's Jimmy Cricket.
Yep. You know? Mm-hmm.
Very good.
Thank you.
Very, very good.
Could anyone have done it better?
I know one of you guys has a good one on this.
So I got...
I have your standard cliche ones, but go ahead.
All right, so the ones... I have three people, I think, that would have played Russell a little bit better.
Oh, okay.
Okay. I put...
Now, is this for the time period or this now?
I would say the time period. Okay. I picked these because I kind of picked them during this time period. So one was Viggo.
Wow. Yeah. This would have been right around Lord of the Rings.
Lord of the Rings. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's pretty good.
I look at the hair, you know, I just think he just would fit the persona pretty well.
Oh yeah. He's got that like mystique.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
I threw Christian Bale in there.
This is him. This is pre Batman Begins.
This is where I have. Yes.
That's pretty
cool. And then the last one I did, Heath Ledger.
Wow.
Yeah, that's pretty good too. So I think Christian Bale would have been awesome because he could, I would have had him keep his British accent.
Yeah.
He's a British musician.
He would have just kept it like that.
Mm. That would have been cool, man.
That would have been dope. But knowing him, he wouldn't have wanted that. He probably would have been like, oh, no.
Do an American accent.
So that's what I would have said. I think
Lobo.
You know what? I didn't think anybody could have done this one better. That's how I feel about this movie.
I mean, it is a very tight, it's a very concise film. It's cut perfectly.
Going back and doing the research on it, so I'm a huge Entourage fan, like the movie, but the TV show Entourage, and it's this, kind of that same thing. I listened to their podcast, Victory, and going back and doing the research on this movie, they have that same tightness that they all talk about. Like this was magic in a bottle. Like If it was this cast that did it this well, and if you really replaced anybody or did something different, it would change the whole thing.
Yeah.
Probably wouldn't be the same. So that's, I left this one alone and said, just
cool.
Yeah. Let's keep it. Cool.
I just said, director wise, because, and me and Gabe has had this conversation numerous times. There's only a few directors that can make you feel like you're in the time period.
Yeah.
And that's Quentin Tarantino and Paul Thomas Anderson. Like, you watch their movies and you know you're in the 70s. Like, it looks like the 70s.
Yeah.
It shot like it's in the 70s. The colors.
Everything. Yeah. Yeah. No.
So I think
they go all in.
All in.
On
the, they're shooting on film.
Yes. They go all in. Yeah.
I think those two guys, I mean, you know, they could have done it better. I mean, not necessarily they could have done it better,
but if
it might have looked better stylistically.
All right. Look, yeah, but Quentin behind this story,
he would have changed it.
It would have been like crazy.
Would have been interesting.
It would have been interesting, but, and then there would have been a lot more feet shots.
The foursome would have been all feet, huh?
It would have been the whole, yeah. Any high school yearbook quotes?
Yes.
You got one?
I am a golden god.
Yeah.
Of course. Mine was be honest and unmerciful.
Who said that?
Lester.
Oh,
surprised that you didn't even say anything about Lester, man.
I have a couple of them. I have another one. Go ahead.
Well, of course, it's all happening.
That's the one I had too. Yeah.
I put a Lester one down too. You'll meet them all again at the long journey to the middle.
Yep.
Yeah.
So I had that one in there.
Of course, what your almost attempted murderer says, does does anyone remember laughter? Because that's the one, that's what Robert Plant used to say whenever he would perform live before he did Stairway to Heaven.
Yeah.
But the big one for me, of course, also was a Lester Banks quote. The only currency in this bankrupt world is what you share with someone else when you're uncool.
Yeah.
Wow. That one's great.
Yeah, it is.
I had another one was Let's Say All the Things We Never Said.
Mm, yeah.
That's fucking great.
Yeah.
It's because I'm great.
I think I'm going to use that one on my wife.
Mine's I'm a golden god.
Yeah. I am a golden god.
And it was he goes, I'm on drugs.
Yes.
Yeah. is there a better title? No.
I think I like Penny Lane would be cool.
Yeah, but then you're putting it in a box, I think.
Okay. Well, I gotcha.
I did put down One Day You Will Be Cool. I don't
know. Oh, okay.
That's pretty good.
That's good. Too long though, but it's good.
Yeah, it is.
That's
good. I think they consider what Tangerine is was a
yeah, and the other
it was
one,
untitled for a long time.
Yeah, yeah. And the one that really stuck out to me from their choices was I'm with the band.
I'm with the band.
And that's like these are like choices of the cast. Like,
yeah.
So Cameron Crowe would have the cast and crew drop names into a box like potential titles of the film because they shot it as untitled.
Yeah. Right.
So
wow.
Yeah, that was kind of cool. Cliche, but good.
Final thoughts, anybody? Are there any unanswered questions, you think?
Or? What happened to Stillwater?
Yeah, I have that one down, too.
Oh, Everybody wants to know.
And after that, because I could see this happening because of my own experiences, after the potential plane crash where they all admit everything.
Oh, yeah. Great scene.
Do they hate each other?
Well, they cut to the other scene where they're all back together later.
But it's like... Well, is it in their head still, you know?
It's funny how we're coming to the conclusion of our podcast.
There it is, right
and
there.
We're actually seeing the final scenes.
Mm-hmm.
What is answering your question, Chris, right here. Where everyone's family's happy now. The band's enjoying. Like, I think they just let everything out. Like, everyone experienced this whole thing.
Yeah.
And it's just like this weight is off them.
Yeah. And Cameron Crowe said when they're filming this, 92-day shoot, one of the crew members comes up and says, like, wouldn't therapy have been cheaper?
Oh, wow.
I think the only other thing that I have is, you know, Penny and William, could they actually have a relationship or a friendship outside of the circus?
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, because a lot of times, like, this is what makes you connected to that
person. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because you got to think about it, they kind of both needed each other.
At the time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because
even Russell.
Being in the circus.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, interesting. All right. R.I.P. Is there any R.I.P.?
I didn't have anything.
You got the sleepwalker? Yeah. Well, you got Philip Seymour Hoffman.
Oh, yes. God, yeah.
You also have... You have Alice Crowe, which is Cameron's mother.
Oh, yes.
And she is in the movie, and she's in all of his movies until she passed away.
It's like Scorsese's which mom.
2019.
I saw on the this thing called the internet that I guess his mom was on, like, obviously on set and then always was conversating with, what's the actress name that played the mother? Like, he did try to keep her away.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, like, you know, just like, leave it alone, Mom.
Yeah.
Leave it alone, Mom. So, all right, guys. Is this a good movie?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, for me, it's because it defined a lot of, you know, a lot of my life in the music industry. Like, I kind of took everything they said and took it with me. I can relate to that t-shirt argument where...
Everybody's out of focus except
Russell's
for Russell.
In the front. I can totally relate to that. I've had that argument millions of times.
Did you wear a shirt with your face on it?
Did I wear one? No, but I would have.
But isn't that funny? Not to cut you off, but it's funny how Jeff, how he's against the machine. He's against the enemy.
Yeah.
But, give to the kids the name, the enemy, this and that. But then they're like, oh, like, we're going to put you on the cover. We're on the cover, guys.
Yeah, I know. It's such a big deal.
And then he's sitting there still talking shit with his face on his shirt.
Mm-hmm.
It's just hilarious.
Musicians.
Yeah, that's just great.
Yeah.
How about you?
I think, overall for me, this is a great movie. It's one of my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
I know I'm kind of skipping a little bit in front, but for me, it's a 8 or 9 out of 10. You know, it's one of my go-tos all the time. We already talked about one of my top fives.
Mm-hmm.
And then I, you know, doing the history and looking at that and how the cast and crew said this was like family filming this movie only makes it better for me.
And you can feel it.
You can feel it. Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. This is a great ass movie.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It hits home.
It does, though, because
it hits home even though it's not home.
Yeah. it's just like how you said. I think you put it in some good words that, you know, it's just something you relate to. It's just a part of like how you lived and, you know, what you experience. And I think it's the same thing for me too. It's just an experience of like the people that I'm around.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I mean, that's my job. My job is to document and to tell people's stories.
And you've met all of these characters.
Met every single one of these people on this damn film,
yeah.
Which is really, really, really crazy. Like, not literal people out there. Okay, so people are like, "Damn, you met all these." Yeah. No, I'm just saying in general.
So, if you're to watch this movie in a double feature, what are you going to show it with?
I think I'm going Jerry Maguire. Mm. It's just because it's two feel-good movies.
Okay.
Two Crowes?
Yeah, two Cameron Crowes that are feel-good movies.
Does Jerry Maguire have the same feeling at the end?
Yeah.
Yeah, same. You know, yeah, I would say so. It's a journey, learning about yourself, learning about the people around you, and then at the end of the day, you come to the conclusion of you're happy who you are and, you know, who comes into your life and... Mm. Things of that nature, man. You grow.
Mm-hmm.
You grow.
I would go with another movie that we should probably do on our podcast, now that I'm thinking about it, that has been overlooked, and it has to be one of Mark Wahlberg's best performances, Rockstar.
Yeah.
Oh, Rockstar.
Not Contraband.
No. or any one of the Transformers.
So. Okay. I love Rockstar, though.
That was a good one. Yep. I haven't seen that one in a while, too.
Like, that's another one, too. It's like, I think those two together, wow. Because one's 80s, one's 70s.
Yeah.
You know?
Wow. Kind of cool.
That's my double feature right there.
There you go. All right.
So, rankings out of 10, Wacko?
For this film?
Yeah.
Oh, man. I got to give it a good solid 9.
Okay. And Gabe, you said...
I'm a 9 on it.
9?
Yeah.
I'm a 10 out of 10.
Wow.
Woo! Nice.
Because, you know, if I'm going there to drop my ass on a deserted island, this is going to be one of those movies I'm taking with me.
Nice.
You know, but...
I agree. Wow, this was a good one, man. I love this one.
A good choice, guys.
Yeah, good job.
Good job, everybody. Good job, everybody. Well, hopefully you guys all enjoyed this podcast. Make sure you go ahead and check out our previous podcast, which is on all platforms. You can find it everywhere. And in the future, obviously on YouTube as well, too. We're going to be putting up the podcasts up there. So be sure to check out that.
Like and follow.
Yes, like and follow us on Instagram. We're not hard to find. 90 Minutes on Film. And yeah. Hopefully you guys catch the next one. So we'll catch you guys on the next one. The next one we're doing, actually, guys, it would be Rock and Rolla.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh. Guy Ritchie.
Yes.
Ooh, that one's going to be a fun one there. So, all right. So get the cocaine, the whiskey, and let's rock.
Peace.
See ya.